Oh, what a blessing it is to be in God's house one more time. We're oh so thankful to be in the place of worship. I hope you're ready to give God a true and real praise on this Wednesday evening. We're here for the refuel service. Why don't you go ahead and get up off your seat and let's praise a true and living God. So thankful again for being in the place of worship on this evening. God has truly been good to each and every one of us. We welcome all guests. We welcome the Mount Zion Church. And on behalf of our pastor, again, we're thankful for you worshiping with us on this day. Scripture reading from today, and I'm reading again from the New International Version. Scripture reading comes from the first number of the psalm, and it says, "Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like the chaff that the wind blows away. Wherefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. That's the entire first number of the psalm. And at this time, we also move into a prayer moment. As we do each and every week, we want to be prayerful for the Mount Zion Baptist Church and for our pastor, Reverend Dr. G.B. Clark. We want to lift up all churches and all pastors that are open in the name of Jesus. We want to be prayerful for all those suffering under any of the natural disasters that are happening, whether hurricanes, fires, whatever. We just ask for God to have his hand upon those individuals. We want to lift up those suffering under COVID-19. We want to be prayerful for those also suffering under HIV/AIDS. We want to remember those suffering under cancer. We lift up individuals that are unsaved. We lift up individuals that are incarcerated. We want to lift up the sick. We want to lift up the shut in. Remember the bereaved and remember the elderly. Remember the widows and orphans. We want to be prayerful for our military personnel. We want to pray for all families and especially our children. We lift up our leaders and the President of the United States, Israel, all foreign countries, all individuals in authority. We just ask God to have his way in all those things that we are duty bound to pray for. Won't you just take this moment, bow with me, and let's go to God in prayer. Oh God, we thank you. God, we bless you for this privilege, God, to come together in worship. And for God, we recognize, God, that you, God, saw fit to give us this another day, unique in the manner that we've never seen it before, and one that we shall never see again. God, you brought us through this entire week from last week up until this point. And for that, God, I just want to pause and say thank you. I thank you, God, for all that you've done in this place, for the Mount Zion Church, for our pastor, for the membership. God, we just want to say thank you on this evening. We lift you up, God, for all the good things that you are doing. God, we understand that so many are standing in the very need of prayer. God, whether it's that they're sick, whether, God, it's that they're shut in. God, and even in these moments, God, we ask for your presence, God. We understand many are still bereaved, God. We understand many are still dealing with financial situations and various needs, God, beyond even that I've read. We just ask you right now, God, would you have your way? God, touch like only you can. Do, God, like only you're willing to do, God, and just have your way. God, we thank you in advance, God, for the presence, God, of your power, God, and your spirit in this place. God, if you would, continue to touch in this worship experience. Touch, God, our media team, God. Touch the musicians, God. Touch the praise team, God. Every song that goes forth, every word that comes forth, God, I ask that you bless it, God. Touch your preacher. Give him the power to proclaim your uncompromising gospel. And God, we thank you in advance for all that you shall do. God, we just bless your name. And God, we ask all these things in the powerful, matchless name of your son, Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. Again, we thank you again for being with us on this evening. We want to, again, thank the Mount Zion Church for your consistency in your giving. We recognize that even in these mediums, part of worship still is to give, and we thank you for that. Reminder to those that are listening that might not be aware, you can give via PayPal, you can give via Zelle. You also can drop off your gifts to the church Monday through Thursday. Please call and make sure someone is here to receive you, but then you also can mail those gifts in. We just ask that you might do that, and we thank you in advance for all of your support. Mount Zion, we also want you to remember there are many opportunities still to be with us, not just in worship, but in Bible study. You must recognize that upcoming on tomorrow, we'll have Bible study at 6:30 on Thursday. And then, of course, our worship service on Sunday. We'll start, though, with Sunday school at 9:30, worship at 10:30. On Sunday evening, there's a 6 p.m. Bible study. On Monday evening, there's teachers meeting at 6:30, followed by Bible study at 7:30. And then on Wednesdays at noon, we have Bible study also. Many opportunities for you to learn about our Lord and our God. Listen, as we move forward in this worship on this evening, we ask that you might, again, gather yourself. Get up. Get ready to praise God with us as this praise team comes back.
just wanna be happy. But if I keep on doing the things that keep on bringing me pain, there's no one else I can blame. If I'm not happy, wasting time, but now I can see the biggest enemy, it was me. So I'm not happy. Cry yourself to sleep, shout and raise your hands. It won't change a thing, child, until you understand. If you're tired of being the same, if you're tired of things not changing, it's time for you to get out the way. Don't get stuck in how you feel. Say, Jesus, take the wheel. Keep on giving my heart for people to tear apart. The healing will never start. So I can be happy. Will I ever be happy? Cry yourself to sleep, shout and raise your hand. It won't change a thing, child, until you understand. If you're tired of being the same, if you're tired of things not changing, it's time for you to get out the way. Don't get stuck in how you feel. Say, Jesus, take the wheel. He knows the road that you need to take. It's so easy to complain, addicted to the pain. You give your heart, they push it away. Jesus knows just how you feel. Just let him take the wheel. The love you need, he already gave. Do you want to be happy? Just want to be happy. Let me hear you say, yeah, yeah, yeah. Let me hear you say, yeah, yeah, yeah. Say yeah, yeah, yeah. Let me hear you say yeah, yeah, yeah. If you're tired of being the same, if you're tired of things not changing, it's time for you to get out the way. Don't be stuck in how you feel. Say, Jesus, take the wheel.
God, praise God, glory to God, glory to God for this praise team and their worship and song. With all protocols already set in place, if you will turn with me to the book of Genesis, God has a word for us on this evening, and it is found in the book of Genesis, as in this season we've all been challenged to bring a word from God out of the book of Genesis, the book of beginnings, Genesis, and we will come from chapter 1, Genesis chapter 1, reading verses 1 through 5. And you've probably already heard some sermons from this, but God has another word for you. We can read this a billion times and always find something new because of the brevity and the masterful word of God. And so Genesis chapter 1, very first book of the Bible, very first verse, reading verses 1 through 5. And the word of God reads, "In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. For a few moments on this evening, on this Wednesday night, I want to talk to you from the thought and the title of The Becoming of Light. The Becoming of Light. That very first verse says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. This is a prologue and an epilogue of the whole entire Bible. It is a beginning and the end. It is the beginning and the end of the whole entire Bible, because in the beginning, God created heaven and earth. But if we flip and fast forward to the book of Revelation, toward the end of the book of Revelation, it also says in the end, that the old heaven and the old earth passed away, and there was a new heaven and a new earth in the end. And so right there in the very first verse of the whole entire Bible, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, is a prologue and an epilogue, is the beginning and the end. And there is a new heaven and a new earth, and then it will pass away, and then there shall be another, a new beginning, another new heaven and another new earth, because God had to change the state of the first one, because the first one had fell into darkness. And so there was a change of state. But it also says in the book of Revelation that there will no longer be a need for the sun, because God will be the light. God will be the light for the new heaven and the new earth. And so God has made the new heaven and the new earth luminous. He has made them light. Because he changed the state of being of the heaven and the earth. And man, if you look at yourself, if you walk a little bit closer, if you come a little bit closer into that very first verse where you see the heaven and the earth, man is a microcosm of heaven and earth. Man is the epicenter, the epitome of heaven and earth. He is a microcosm of heaven and earth, because if you look at the body of man, it is earth. The parallel verse to this, if you go there in your time of study, is Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. Man is made, God made man from the dust of the ground, that's earth, from the dust of the earth. And he breathed into him the breath of life. He breathed into him the ruach. He breathed into him spirit. And so man is heaven, spirit residing in body. Earth, a microcosm of what God created in the beginning, heaven and the earth. But our problem is that we've lost our connection in man. We lost our connection to the Holy Spirit of God. We lost our connection to God. And we found ourselves, like in verse 2, much like the earth, without form. A wasteland, desolate, empty, void, full of darkness. Because without the Spirit of God, without the connection to God, your goodness that we think we do, our work that we claim we do, the work that we proclaim we do, it's good for nothing. It's waste. It's void. It's darkness. And God has to move upon us. God has to brood upon us. God has to sit upon us. God has to come unto us and communicate to us a word that will change our state. It says right there in the second half of verse 2, it says, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. When you find yourself in the dark places, when you find yourself in the darkness, you've got to move to God and allow him to move upon you. You allow him to brood upon you. The word move there in the Hebrew is the word rakah. Rakab, and it simply means to brood upon, to sit upon, like a mother hen sits upon her eggs. He sits upon you. As Jesus Christ, when he came into us, came into the world as a man, and he brooded upon us. He sat upon us. He got into us. He stepped into our flesh and he brooded upon us. Then the Spirit of God moved upon the earth. It moved upon the words of the world. It moved upon the words of man and was able to change the state of man if man allowed God to rest upon him and to help our problem, our sin problem, our darkness problem, our voided problem, our wasteless problem, our formless problem, to help our problem in sin and the iniquity that we find ourselves growing up in. We've got to allow God to move upon the very essence of who we are. We've got to allow God to move upon our hearts. We've got to allow God to move upon our words. We've got to allow God to move upon our desires. We've got to allow God to move upon our actions so that there may be light. You see, when God moved upon the waters, if you know anything about water, come on, somebody, if you know anything about water, water receives light and then it reflects light. and so when God moved upon the waters and the Spirit of God moved upon the waters, God, who is light, who is the very source of light, where light comes from, when God moved upon the waters, when he sat upon it and he brooded upon it and he hovered over it, as some translations say, he hovered over the waters, the water simply reflected the image of God before all of existence. And God said, let there be light. God didn't say, let light be, because light is him, and he is the be. He is the all of existence. But he said, let light, let there, in the darkness, in the wastefulness, in the voidedness, in our sinfulness, in our iniquity, let there be light. And the word of God says, and there was light. Because the word of God, when it moves upon you and you reflect what you receive from it, it brings forth an image that is light. It is luminous. It is life changing. It changes your state of being. It allows God to become your portion. And what does that mean? Your portion means the very essence of who you are. Your portion is the very being, every fiber of your being, all the way down to the bone and the marrow, to the soul and to the spirit. It moves upon you and it changes your state of being. And there you become light. Light. If we look at Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, Jesus says it himself. He says, you are the light of the world. A city that sits on a hill cannot be hid. And so when you allow God to change your state of being, when you allow God to move upon you, your very essence, your waters, your word, your spirit, he changes your state of being and you become light. But what is light? If we open up our science books, the science book will tell you that light is simply a massless packet of energy, a massless packet of energy called a photon. But there's more to it than that. There's more to it, because we see that light is a reflection. It is an image of God himself. But watch this. Man was made in the image of God and after his likeness. Verse 26 of this same chapter, God says, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. And that image and that likeness is light. Because Jesus is the great light that came to be with us. Emmanuel, God with us, the great light that came to live amongst us and move upon us and brood upon us and change our state of being and give us a new beginning and give us eternal life in him. He is the image. He is the light. And if you look at first in the book of John, the Gospel of John, it talks about in him, in Jesus Christ was life. And his life was the light of men. And so we've got to allow Jesus to get into us. We've got to allow Jesus, who is the Word of God, who is the light, who is the way, who is the truth, who is a God Almighty. We've got to allow him to get into us and change our state of being, change our darkness, change our desolation, change our wastefulness. Change us so that we can be in his image, image bearers in the earth, shining in the darkness, and the darkness understands it not. But what else? What else is light? If we look at physical light, physical light is actually the electromagnetic force, the electromagnetic force, which is one of the four forces in the physical universe. You have gravity, the strong force, the weak force, and the electromagnetic force. And the electromagnetic force, to put it simple, is light. But there's seven different aspects of light that we all seem to live in and move in, but we can only see one of them. And that's what we perceive to be light. But light is more than that. You have radio waves. Radio waves are light. And radio waves, we communicate over radio waves. We communicate general language over radio waves. And then you have microwaves. And we think about microwaves from the microwave that's in our kitchen. But it's more than that, because cell phone signals and other types of communication travel over microwave waves. And those type of waves are a straight communication. It's a straight communication in that it can be heated up. It could be a heated type of communication. And then you have what's called infrared light. And infrared light is a light that is based on temperature. And if you could see an infrared light, then you could see if someone was hot or cold. You can see if somebody was alive. Insects and mosquitoes, that's how a mosquito can find you, because it sees an infrared light and it sees your warmth and it sees your temperature. Vipers and snakes, and they see your temperature because they can see an infrared light, and they can test your temperature and see if you're something that they need to bite. And then you have visible light. That's what we live in. And visible light, it comes upon us in order to give us a perspective of life. It puts life into perspective. It comes before you and it gives you light. Without visible light, you would not have life at all. But then you move into another spectrum of light, and that's ultraviolet light. And we hide from the ultraviolet rays and we put on the suntan lotion. But ultraviolet light, as we've learned in this pandemic, is both good and bad, because it's good because when you shine a UV light over something, it can kill bacteria, it can kill viruses, and so it can clean you up, and it can clean up a surface and clean up a situation. But if you reject the cleaning up of the situation and you use it in the wrong way, then it can be bad, because it's harmful to the skin. It can cause cancer and cause all types of darkness, all types of infirmities, and eventually destroy you. But then you move into another type of light, which is X-ray. And we use X-rays all the time because X-rays is a type of light that can see eternally. It can see into your body and see the structure of you. It can see the structure of things. It can see the structure of your life. It can see the organization of your life and shine a light upon it so that you may see what you need to fix. But then we move to the seventh type of light, and that's the gamma ray. A gamma ray light is the most powerful light of all, because the gamma ray light cuts down through bone and marrow. It cuts down through soul and spirit. It cuts down into your atoms. It cuts down into your subatomic particles. It cuts you and divides you in half and situates you if need be. And God uses, we can only see one of these types of light, but God sees them all. And he communicates to us through them all, because light is a type of communication. It's a word. Come on, somebody. We understand that God is light and God is the word. He is in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. And so he communicates to us through his light, through his word. And so he communicates to us first in the radio wave, in general communication. You can see the word of God and the principles of the Bible in nature, in the universe. You can see it is there. That's what Romans was talking about. It's the food says in his heart that there is no God, because you can see God in general revelation and just looking out. Things don't come about just to be, just out of happenstance. There is a creation which points to a creator. It's general revelation. It's general communication. And God speaks to us through this general communication. But if you didn't get that, he could talk to you straight. He could talk to you straight, and he can heat up the communication and let you know that it's him that's talking to you. But if you can't see that, then he can test your temperature. He can see if you're hot or cold. And just like the church in Laodicea, he looked and saw them and saw that they were neither hot or cold, and they were lukewarm. And so he said he will spit you out because you were lukewarm. God sees into you and sees your temperature. He sees where you are in him. And if you accept him, then he comes into your life and puts your life into perspective. He puts your life into order. He puts your life and cleans it up and makes you a new creature in Christ Jesus. He cleans you up. But if you but watch this. In the ultraviolet rays of God's communication, he cleans you up. But if you reject the communication, then he has to send a darkness. He has to send a infirmity. He has to send a problem. He has to send a circumstance. He has to send something into your life to get you to put yourself in order, because that next type of light is that X-ray, and it sees down into your order. It sees down into your structure, because God will send something into your life that will have you put your life in order. Change your structure so that it is in line with him, in line with his light. But then if you can't get it, then the word of God in Ephesians, it says, for the word of God is quick. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 12, the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intent of the heart. The gamma ray is the light that pierces into your subatomic particles. It moves through your bones and your marrow, and it splits you and separates you. And the word of God communicates to you that way. It separates you. And this is light. It's communicating to us every day. It makes us light. But you got to go through the process. You got to go through the process where he changes your being. And you can't be afraid of the process. You've got to love a word that cuts you. You've got to love a word that changes your being. You've got to love a word that changes your structure. You've got to love a word that cleans you up. You got to love a word that puts life into perspective. You got to love a word that heats you up. You got to love a word that's straight to the point. And you got to love a word that shows up everywhere. It's the word of God, and it's light. And it has made you light. It is the becoming of light. It is the journey of light. And God said in verse 4, he says he saw the light. He saw the light in you. And he said it was good. And you've got to see that it's good. No one loves the suffering. No one loves the anguish. No one loves the darkness. No one loves the process. But it's the process that makes you a kind of him. Come on, somebody. It's the process that makes you more of an image like him. It's a process that makes you like unto him. It's the process that changes your state of being and heats you up and makes you luminous. It makes you a light. It is the becoming of the light. It's the change of state. Ah, come on, somebody. When you look at the light from a fire, what you're actually seeing is the change of state. You're seeing a wood log being changed into something gaseous, something chemical. And that change of state lets off a light. It lets off a packet of massless energy, and it comes to you in the form of visible light. When you see the charcoal, or when you're barbecuing, it's changing the state. And when you see God has hovered over you and has put his word in you and is starting to change you, he's changing you from what you used to be into what he has created you to be, which is light. He is changing your state, and we've got to move in with God in order for him to change our state of being, in order for us to become a new creature in Jesus Christ. We've got to allow him to change our state. But it says also, it says, and then God, he saw the light was good. And then he divided the light from the darkness. How does God divide the light from the darkness? He does it through sacrifice. Come on, somebody. In order for you to go from what you used to be, in order for you to go from the old man into the new man, in order for you to change from darkness, in order for you to change from a voidness, in order for you to change from without form, you've got to go through sacrifice. You've got to take up your cross and follow Jesus Christ. He changed his state when he came into the world and stepped out of time and stepped out of eternity and into time. He changed his state when he took off glory and put on flesh. He changed his state when he took off light and put on darkness. When he changed his state when he was born of a virgin some 2,000 years ago, traveled through 42 generations and was born in a manger. He changed his state when he when he grew up as a tender shoot before our eyes. He changed his state when he waxed strong and grew strong in the spirit and in favor with God and in favor with man. He changed his state when he walked among us and lived among us, and he lived for us. And he changed his state when he healed the blinded eye. He changed his state when he healed the man with the lame hand. He changed his state when he changed our darkness. He changed his state when he changed our form and made us formful. He changed his state when he walked up Calvary's hill, when he walked up Golgotha's mountain. He changed his state when he climbed up that old rugged cross. He changed his state when he hung his head in the locks of his shoulders and said, "It is finished. It is done. It is the end. I am the beginning and the end." He changed his state, and he died. He died all day. He died all day, all night Friday, all day Saturday. But on the third day, early Sunday morning, he woke up with all power in heaven and on earth. He changed his state. He changed his state. And he is calling you, if you will grasp onto him, if you will believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, he will change your state too. He will carry you and pick you up and turn you from what you used to be, which was darkness, voidness, desolation. He will change that state and make you life and give you eternal life and make you luminous. He will change your state. But watch this. It didn't stop there. Because when you change your state in Jesus Christ, as he changed his state for you in order for you to have his eternal life, he ushers you into a new day. The first day had to pass away. Because after he divided the light from the darkness, the word of God says that he called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and evening and morning was the first day. That first day, even that day, had to change its state. But when Jesus died on a cross, he changed the state of the day. And now we get a new day. Now we get a new beginning. Now he moves us into a luminous day. Now he moves us into a luminous heaven and earth. Now he moves us into a luminous body and spirit, a new man, a new creature in Jesus Christ. He has made us luminous. He has made us light. And it's the becoming of light that we have to get on board with. It's the becoming of light that we have to sacrifice what we used to be and what's still stuck in us. We've got to move away from it in order for him to separate us from the darkness of what we still find ourselves in. We have to accept the process and allow God to change our state so that we can enter into the becoming of light.
We praise God for that word on this day. And listen, I pray that you not only heard it, but you embraced it in such a manner that you want to take God's invitation right now of discipleship. Listen, this is your opportunity to give your life to a true and living God. How do you do that? How do you do that? You confess with your mouth and believe in your heart. And this day, you are saved. You do that by admitting that Jesus died and got up on the third day morning. And now is there to the right hand of his Father. But even more so, you attest to the fact that you've sinned and that you need his forgiveness. Listen, if you can do that, confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, you are saved right now. We pray right now that you're taking that opportunity to give your life to God and even more so become a part of the family. My Bible is clear that one day God is coming back and he's coming back for his children. The sky is going to open up. And when he comes back, I pray that you are a part of that church without spot or wrinkle. This is your opportunity right now. If you've done that, that means you've given your life to God. And we want to know about it. I need you to reach out to the church. I need you to let the church office know that you've given your life to a true and living God. And I believe one day soon, you'll be able to put your hand in pastor's hand. One day soon, you'll be able to feel, even with him standing there, the whole congregation embracing you for your newfound relationship with God. And we're oh so thankful for that at this time. Listen, again, if you've done it, we are blessing God for it. But even if not, there is still that opportunity for you to do it. You don't have to have the doors of the church open. You don't have to have the doors of the church open literally for you to become a part of the family. So we pray that you're willing to do that. Listen, as we prepare to leave this place right now, we're also thankful for everything that has taken place. Let's hear from God right now with his benediction. Oh God, we thank you and bless you, God, for the privilege of worship. And God, we ask that you might be with us. And God, allow your spirit to keep this word moving upon our hearts. Touch our musicians, touch our audiovisual team, touch these praise team members and your preacher, God, for all that has occurred in this place. We thank you and we bless you, God, for all that you've done. Now unto him who was able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy, be it now the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Let the church say together, amen, amen, and amen. God bless you and God keep you is our prayer. We'll see you next week.